down south on introduction tour, long and hard with our colleagues at Merseytravel. I think we recognise that £2.30 for one stop and two stop is a lot for people to pay. But again, I would argue that if they are regular users, then they wouldn't buy it anyway. They buy the day ticket because it's cheaper to buy the day ticket, or it's even cheaper to buy the weekly ticket. But I would also say that £2.30 from the likes of St Helens into Liverpool, from Southport into Liverpool, is the opposite, whereas it's really good value when you're travelling 15 miles for £2.30. So that is the problem with the flat fare. I can't deny that. We have a flat fare for simplicity reasons, and it does have its downfalls, but in the main, it does make it a lot easier for both the customer and the drivers. But I do accept that it'll never go away. So I would again say that we probably would have no objection to sitting down and having a discussion.
Yes, Steve.
Yeah, mine again is about fare structures, in particular. Your service across the River Mersey is actually the most expensive way to cross the river. I think it's at £3.30 going out to Liverpool city centre. Ferry would be £2.50, train £2.70, stagecoach £2.70. And you've just spoken about how you've increased the number of people taking that as an alternative to train. If you were to reduce that fare and make it more competitive, isn't that a way of sustaining that extra custom and really reduce the fare more? Travel by bus across the river. So I would ask you to look at that as a particularly way of focusing a better deal for your customers and retaining the new customer that you've got. So it's the most expensive way across the river, and how can you justify that? And you will benefit from the fast tag reduction as your buses are regular crosses as well.
Yeah, I think it's a fair question. I think again, I would point out that two things. One is there's a weekly ticket, £17, it's valid for 7 days. Even if people go to work for 5 days, it's far cheaper to buy the weekly ticket than it is to pay the £3.30 single. It's normally ad hoc people that only buy the £3.30, it's not regular users. What we've also done, and I'm hoping that you picked it up, is the day ticket used to be £5.30, it's now only £4.60. So rather than somebody buying a £3.30 single, which probably doesn't make sense, they'd be much better off buying the £4.60 day ticket, which is now valid across the river, because we've just reduced it from £5.30. So that was our way of doing it. Then. Okay, sir.
Thank you very much, Chair. We have a couple of questions in the main chair, just to say one of the things that we found through the network meeting is just how difficult it can be to help people live in the more isolated communities. And I've seen down in the south-southeast of the country, we've done a sort of down-the-ride schemes. And I wonder if that's something that the lessons learned as we brought into here, because it's difficult to balance the commercial aspect with the social aspect of those who live in the cars. Secondly, because I always like to raise issues on the green, on my green credentials, it's about what you're going to do about increasing the number of vehicles in the green. So you've got the ones that are up to, what is it, the Euro 6, isn't it?
Yeah, the new ones are Euro 6, yeah.
Are you going to bring some more of that over and above where you've had a bit into the funding for that? Because more and more, and it was interesting that you say about the property in London, I think you're seeing the greater drive to take away the conventional kind of view of vehicles. But encapsulating those two questions.
Okay. Can't remember what the first one was.
We want to dial a ride. Dial a ride,
okay.
Funny
enough, you are right, we've just started. Funny enough, we've just started the DRT scheme. We've got a young lady that's running the operation down in southern counties, and it's demand sponsored transport. So if that's a success, then I think she's already going to be in touch with Matt to talk about certain areas within the network reviews. If can't be covered for whatever reason, is there a better way of doing that? And I think it's in its infancy at the moment, but it's definitely the way it's going to go, certainly in the outlying areas. I would also say that one of the other things that operators have done, and I know that we're looking at it in the rural areas of Cheshire, is again minibus operations, so maybe 8, 12, 15 seaters, where you can call upon them and book them as a taxi. So again, we can look at that operation as well for certain areas that aren't covered by the commercial services. So I do think there's definitely options, definitely the DRT is one, and I'm going to have a chat with Matt about putting in touch with Aisha today.
And I think if I hear you right, we're going to shrink the size of the fleet.
Well, I did put up on my presentation that the average age is 5.8, which is probably behind London, but certainly ahead of the game as far as the rest of the UK is concerned. There is no doubt that we've had great support from DB. As far as they're concerned, if the funding is available from the DFT, we worked very hard in putting the submission forward for the 51 hybrids. We were very successful in doing it, and the electric vehicles, we are very keen again to work with them. If that funding is available, then there is no doubt I would suggest both Stagecoach and Arriva will definitely put another bid in. But that won't stop us still investing in our fleet going forward, because it's got to be a continual investment, because we'll have vehicles for 15 years that will drop out and need replacement. So it will always be a continued investment.
Jeremy? Thank you, Chair. As part of the alignment of the 86A became a 24-hour route, how is this performing, and do you have any plans to introduce other late night or 24-hour service on other major corridors?
Do you want the honest truth? A lot depends on when the students are in. So if the students are in, then it's very well used. If the students are not in, it's not very well used, which tells its own story. So at the moment, we had it as an additional trial for 6 months. We've extended it for a further 6 months. Would we be willing to look at other routes? I think I'd have to be convinced at the moment that the 24-hour on the 86A works. Because if it doesn't work on the 86A and it relies wholly on students, I would be very surprised if it would work on any of the other major corridors. But never say never, Jim.
Yes. In your ward. It was interesting to listen to your interpretation of some of the figures. If you look at the young person's fare package, which includes the massively successful waiting year, massive, it's the biggest in the country, and fare reductions for young people so that they pay only half fare, it's all been just an amazing success. Seen over 80% more journeys made by young people. My heart bled for you when you said, but there's a cost to that. I was tempted to get the violin out the bag, but I've left it there. The vast majority of the 9% patronage growth is down to youngsters as well. We believe that this shows that a good quality offer that's simple to understand, you spoke about wasn't a big marketing thing. Simple to understand, to advertise and to market, has drawn customer growth like that. You know, better than anywhere else in the country, without a doubt. So, you have two questions. You like them. How will you be looking to apply the same principles to other adult groups to generate the same growth? I look slightly more than your 9%. Look at 15, that's ambitious. And what plans do you have to put in place for older teenagers and the 19 to 21 age range to make it better and more affordable for them?
I think 19 to 21 are concerned, I think that's probably the next big topic. I think we've obviously, when we did the under 19s, one thing that we didn't do is we didn't introduce a card, because our experience from Manchester was that as soon as you bring something in that puts a stumbling block in front of it, it won't get used or people won't do it. So we took a risk with increasing the aids. It certainly worked as far as generating passengers. Don't need to get the violin out. But I do think 19 to 21 is the next stage. I actually think 19 to 23 is the next stage, not 21.
Fabulous.
It's on the record as well now.
I've said this because it's important that we keep people with us. So at the moment we've got people travelling for half fare at the age of 18, and that's still not enough for me, because I think it will still make them buy their own car after that. So I think if we keep them even longer to the university, I think you've got a better chance of keeping them full stop, because once they get used to using the bus, they'll hopefully stay with you. Now, Phil Stone won't thank me for this, but if the risk was big for under 19s, it's going to be massive for under 23s. So I think it's just trying to find a way of being able to do that whilst not damaging the commercial network. But I do think there is scope to do more with the child fare. Talking to Liz Chandler, because she's been nagging me for the last 12 months. I think yes, it's a simple answer. We recognise, I think, that keeping jobs within the city region is important, because it helps grow the economy. We also know that apprentices are on the lowest wage, certainly in year one. We know that through our own scheme, and I think we've had some really good conversations about our business to business manager that we just employed is going to have a look at this with a view to giving not 10% discount, but more than that, really, about trying to encourage them to use the bus, because I think if you want them to stay with you, you've got to give them a taste of what they can experience. So I think apprenticeships is hot on the list for the Alliance. It's part of a package that we're looking at. So I would say the simple answer is yes, we are.
Next I've got Harry, then Ken, then John, then Natalie. So Harry.
Howard, going back to your slideshow, I got a feeling I was confused by the same slide last year as I was this year. You showed the area that you have responsibility for, and that covered wrong.
No,
that's fine.
I understand that one corner is part of the combined authority.
Yeah, that's fine.
It's a good spot.
It would have made one of my suggestions pointless if it had changed. The first
Does that depend on the first answer to your question?
Oh, no, no, maybe the 20% of the first answer.
I think it's a good question. I think there is no doubt that the Gateway Bridge has certainly disrupted travel within the Runcorn area. That's had a knock-on effect to our services out of Runcorn. I don't think there's any doubt about that. It's been a real struggle. I think once the bridge is up and running, then obviously, hopefully, we can reassess. And I think the long term, and I would say long term, because it's not my patch, so I can't speak for Phil at the moment, but I would suggest that long term, it would be a lot simpler if the whole area was incorporated into the structure. How that's done, whether I'll be operating or not, is a different matter, but I'll invite Phil to come along. Don't think he'll want me to pinch his patch just at the moment, but I do think it's a relevant question, and I think it's just a matter of timing before Holton comes into the fore. I know I've sort of escaped that a little bit, I'm conscious of that, but I can't give any guarantees at the moment.
So next round, because I confused the two issues, and I'm just making sure. So in terms of the consolidation affair, are you saying in effect that will be a decision for somebody else?
I'm saying that will have to be a decision that we take maybe as part of the alliance or as part of a business case once the gateway is opened and those services recover from the roadworks and the delays that they're having to put at the moment. If we did that at the moment, it would decimate the service over there because they are really struggling with trying to keep the time and reliability. So at the moment, I would suggest no. Long term, I would suggest there's a good chance.
Not
at the moment, Ken, no. I think as far as Arriva Rail North is concerned, obviously part of their franchise was that they had to work a lot closer with all bus operators, not just Arriva. We've already had various meetings with them, we've probably got our fourth, we've got another one on Monday about the links that we can do for easy wins. So we are working hard with them about trying to cross-link, make sure the timetables fit. It's not so bad when you've got a high-frequency train route and a high-frequency bus route. It doesn't really matter because the connections will only be a couple of minutes. What matters is the rural areas or the half hours against the half hours. They're the important ones, and they're the ones I think we have to pick off first. So that work is underway. In fact, my number two who's sitting in the corner is actually leading the project on our behalf with Arriva Rail North. It does take a bit of time. They're not the quickest people to work with. But I think eventually we will get there. And I think that will apply to the ticketing, because we sit on the smart ticketing steering group. And there is no doubt that certainly having our products and stagecoach products on the Walls tickets certainly helped. We are then going to move over, hopefully, to some of the rail operating companies, so you'll be able to have interoperable tickets between the two, and that's got to be good for every passenger. So it's on its way, Ken, but it might just not happen as quick as you like.
What's this way? It's like that.
It's not Harry 7 to 8 the month,
no.
Yeah, we've got.
Yeah, it's not just about River Rail, but it is about Merseyrail as well. We're trying to work a bit more collaboratively with them where we can. And that's part of the network reviews that we've been doing with Matt and Jeanette, looking at those timetables and where we cover stations, can we be more accommodating to make sure we've got that crossover.
John's next.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks, Howard, for your presentation. Yeah, I'd like to know down with this my ticket. Sorry, I know a number of colleagues have also briefly alluded to it earlier on. But I have a concern which is shared by colleagues on the Merseytravel Committee. There's a real danger that we're actually looking to drive the my ticket price up from £2 to £2.20, which I believe is your recommendation, is your preferred price. That's a 10% increase, it's £1 a week. For some hard hit families across Merseyside, that's going to be a problem. So I'd ask you to reconsider that, please, because we believe the my ticket price of £2 set at the level, made it simple, straightforward. People know that they're paying those £2, and it's very straightforward for those youngsters to actually access that. So I'd ask you seriously to look at that again. There is a danger, I'm not going to get nerdish about economic theory, but price inelasticity. I'm just wondering, is there a danger that if you actually price yourself out of the market in one fell swoop, that there's a danger that sort of growth that you've looked at, which was 80% increase in young people, and 9%, which has contributed greatly to the 9%, as Mary and other colleagues have said, there's a danger that will get knocked back. So I'm asking you on behalf of the Merseytravel Committee, if you can, have a really serious look at that again, because we think that's been a real benefit to the youngsters across Merseyside.
I accept that. I think it's a fair comment. I think the only thing I would say is it can't stay. It's not sustainable at £2 for every day. I think, you know, I would love to be able to keep it at £2 for the next 10 years, and please don't write that down. But it just wouldn't be sustainable as part of the business case. I think, you know, a lot of people migrated over from paying the adult fare, and I get the fact that it's going from it's been recommended from £2 to £2.20. I think you have to remember that that's a day ticket, it's not an ordinary single ticket. So a single ticket would only be £1.20 to £1.30. So again, it's a 10% increase, but it's a 10% increase on a day ticket, not a single ticket. I think if we were in a position to sustain that, we have done for 3 years. In fairness, the price was introduced in April 2014. It's not been touched for 3 years. That's a long time to hold your prices down at £2. So I'm not going to make any promises. It would be wrong for me to stand up here and say I don't want to put it up, because I do. Because I think it's necessary for us to be able to make sure that a lot of the commercial services are able to justify that end, because we are trying to do our best to reduce the funding of the Cllr Channel as far as attendance services are concerned. So there's a balancing act, and I get that, but at some point it can't stay at £2 for every day. That's what I'd say.
Natalie.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Howard, for that presentation. Even though I think I needed binoculars to see some of the words, but I appreciated the contribution you've given. And it was really nice to hear that you, Arriva has 110 million turnover for Merseyside, 74 million passengers. And just now you mentioned your last point in terms of you all are committed towards reducing the funding for Merseytravel in one of your contexts. And I have two questions for you, real-time information. I am an avid bus user, and one thing peeves me off quite a bit, bus timing. Sometimes I'm waiting 45 minutes for a bus that is supposed to turn up. I look at the app and basically it shows the bus has been and gone. terms of, you know, it's good hearing 30% of the passengers stayed with, in terms of the track renewal. That's one part of the city. But looking at the wider Merseyside, have you had complaints about buses not being on time? What are you doing to address those situations? Because it can be a turn-off. I've had many times to take a taxi or else I'll be late for work or I'll be late for an appointment. And I'm sure there are many other people like that. So just to find out what you're going to do about that or what you already have in place. The other, as I said, real-time information. Because, again, having that display, I know it's quite expensive, but obviously with the Alliance and working with Merseytravel, I think it would be really good if Arriva, because you've indicated loads of stuff that you're doing, which I wasn't aware of, so that's quite helpful. But in terms of looking at how you can work in Alliance to have real-time information display for passengers, because obviously passengers would value that and want to use your bus service a bit more. Thank you.
Good questions. I think one at a time, I think the real-time information is really, really important. I think it's not so bad if you've got a bus that's every 3 minutes, so you don't need to worry about it, but I think we've got services of 15 minutes, 20 minutes, half hour. I think they're vital. I think as part of the Alliance, one of the milestones is that Matt has just written, on Stewart Thunder, Matt's just written up the project, the real-time information, so we are both on board to make sure that the real-time information gets put out to where it has to be prioritised, so it needs to go to the routes which need it first. So I definitely support real-time information. Matt's got our view on that and we would be happy to support that. I'll go back to the other question, reliability. When we do any customer survey, reliability and punctuality is the top answer. It's the most important thing for any of our customers, and it's vital for us. Do we get complaints about reliability? All the time. Do we have late running? All the time. It's very rare that we have early running, because it's treated extremely serious, because it's a no-go in the bus industry. But we suffer a lot with roadworks and congestion. Some of the late running is our fault, and I think we should accept that it's our fault, and we need to do something about that. But there are other areas which are outside our control that we've brought up with the Alliance. We've highlighted 6 or 7 key networks and routes where hopefully we can improve the bus journeys. If we can do that, and that allows us to take vehicles out in order to keep the reliability, that then means that we can reinvest in other areas. It means that we can also reinvest in other areas of the network. So it's absolutely vital. But it is, I'll give you one example, Edge Lane is just killing us at the moment. And it's, I understand the long-term aim, and I think it's really good. Unfortunately, it doesn't do the day-to-day stuff any good at all. So reliability is our top priority. Top priority.
Terry?
Mine's a little bit years ago, buses used to go from the main bus station, which was the Cllr, to all the outlying terminals, which now appear in the terminals and so on. So we have a bus service that terminates on the middle side of the street in
I'm saying is, if you wait for both the highways officers from all the authorities to say that, will this route have an impact on your roads? How much of an impact is it going to have? And how are we going to get on with it? Feels like that to avoid in the future.
I think it's a fair question. I think we don't go into that. I think it's fair to say don't go into that detail with highways. I think as far as Melanie is concerned, it is a difficult one because we have complaints about the vehicles going on the grass verge, and we know that's an issue. We did look at extending it to Kirby, but the 345 is one where it is just about commercial. If we were to extend it to Kirby, it would cost another vehicle, another two drivers. That cost would probably not pay for the vehicle onto Kirby. And that's the difficulty we have. And again, it goes back to that balance about what is commercial, what is tendered. We don't want to put any more pressure on Merseytravel at the moment, but we recognise that there is an issue there, and it's something I think we're going to have to try and resolve. I think, you know, but even if we went to Kirby, we would still be going through that area 30 times a day, 30 times back. So I think there is a balancing act to have. We try our best to make sure that there's proper turnaround facilities without disturbing the local residents, because I recognise up there everyone uses the bus. So it is a bit of a balancing act. I'm not sure what the answer is for the 345, if I'm really honest.
Sorry to get
caught. No, hey, it's fine. I've got a problem.
Jill.
I think if we're honest, we're always on the lookout for new opportunities and new networks. I think part of the network we've used that we've done with Merseytravel have highlighted areas where not only can we look to change services, but how we can improve the network. So I would never say never. I think it's important that every avenue is looked at, whether or not it's a commercial avenue, I've just said, when you put a new service on, it is difficult to judge what that service is going to do because it has to generate enough revenue to be able to pay its costs. So there's always that in the back of the mind. But I think what the network we use have certainly done is highlight opportunities in certain areas. So whilst you know, Kirby is certainly one, there have probably been three or four other places where we've looked at as well. So I would say yes is the answer. We're always on the lookout.
Just a few from myself as well, now, Howard. Obviously talked quite a bit about tickets and fares today, and you've rapidly pointed out how some of your weekly monthly tickets are really good deals. And that's obviously great if you are a regular sort of monthly rider down to my life.
Yes.
But I think one of the things that we all accept as part of the Alliance is that for particularly people like part-time workers and people with complex caring responsibilities, or kind of irregular kind of patterns of travel, there isn't a really good value offer out there for people. So that's why we've been very keen to look at Cllr tickets. I suppose one of the things we're quite keen to understand is on developing those Cllr tickets, what we think the suitable discounts would be for that, because to actually attract people to buy a Cllr and use a Cllr, not just on the basis of when they have to use the bus, but potentially as people are non-users. Might be prepared to buy that car and they just keep it in their desk or wherever you use it as and when. What do you think the right level of discount should be to get a really good attractive Cllr product?
You'll probably be aware, but in case the audience are not, we are currently working on another range of tickets to be put on the Walrus ticket. One of them is a Cllr solo day tickets. I think we've just got to be careful, if I'm honest, that you don't give a discount on a discount, because the day tickets are automatically discounted anyway, so I think you've got to be careful that you don't discount a discount. I think the Cllr tickets are really important, and I think that that's definitely the way forward. research definitely tells us that there are far more people now working 2, 3, 4 days. We see it in our own industry. We must have part-time rosters in every garage now, and I'm sure that states go chat as well. So it is going to become a really important factor, and I think it is important that you have to get that balance right between what's the commercial price, but what's the value as well. So we were discussing the other day about what does a car name mean? Is it 3, is it 4, or is it both? So I think we've yet to decide what we're going to do and think of the car name tickets. But certainly for us, I think 3 is a good starting point. And that then gives the people the opportunity where they don't have to buy a weekly ticket, they don't have to buy a day ticket, they can buy 3 tickets and then use them as and when they get on the board. And that gives them the flexibility. Because 1 week they might work Tuesday, Wednesday, and the next week they might work Tuesday. So I do think it's important, but I think the pricing has to be set right. I think we just have to be careful with the pricing on it. It has to be attractive enough for people to buy, but if it is attractive enough, it's got to be able to generate enough to be able to make sure that it's a sustainable product. Because the last thing that you want to do is introduce something and then put the price on 12 months later.
Then my next one is all about money and budgets. Obviously, we've just gone through a process over the past couple of years now, working with yourself and all the other operators on the network reviews about how we can develop a clearer network that's simpler for the customer to understand. But obviously, one of the kind of implications is that because we've got a lot less public money to spend on it, how can we sort of do that in a means which kind of reduces the amount of taxpayer money that goes into it, but doesn't leave people without a bus. Now I think we've done that really, really well, working with yourselves and others accordingly. Obviously, because of the government of this country, the public sector finances are looking no better, and we're going to have to look at kind of other ways in which we can cut our cloth accordingly. I'm very conscious about the fact that we pay yourselves and other operators still quite a lot, not just in tendencies, but particularly things like de minimis. Is that part of a detailed conversation we can sort of work on? Because I think, and Ron always reminds me of this, de minimis actually means diminishing. It's there to kind of be a kind of short-term fix to try to keep the commercial service running. It's not a long-term top-up, if you like. So we make sure that's part of a clear conversation, and can you pick up more of that tab than traditions that are kept?
I think in fairness, the network reviews have gone, I think you're right, they've gone really well so far. I think most of the operators have played ball. I think there's a lot of scope to go at still. I think to be fair to the operators, certainly I can't speak for Stagecoach, but I'm sure that David will answer any questions that you want to give him after. We have registered a lot of the de minimis on a lot of the bigger commercial services, and I do think there's a balance to be had between those and the not so commercial services, and I think it's finding a cleverer way of doing things. And I think the way that Merseytravel approached the network reviews have been really refreshing, because it's almost a blank sheet of paper, what can be done, what needs coming in, what's important, and then where's the commercial services. So I think fairness, a lot of hard work to really be done on that. De minimis is certainly an avenue that we've looked at with a lot of the services on reducing that de minimis. And again, it's just finding that balance where, as long as we've got a stable network, then yes, I think de minimis should be reviewed every 12 months anyway, as a matter of course, because if things grow, then obviously the payments should come down. And that's the way it goes to Merseytravel. We've dealt with the last couple of diminishes that we've got. So, for example, 500. So, as the 500 grows, the diminish drops. And that is a good way of ensuring that not all the profit or not all the money can come back to the operators. We're conscious of your purse. And we know it's very tight. We know, I think we're on track for the savings after the first 3 years. I think thereabouts, and on everything, but I think we are getting there with that. But we've certainly no problem about discussing to them.
Right. Okay. And my final one, a little bit further down the road, if you'll excuse the report. As Ron mentioned earlier, the bus services bill is making its way through Parliament. Probably will get Royal Assent within the next month or so.
Maybe.
Lots of new options and opportunities with regard to that piece of legislation. Obviously, the two most significant ones are the ability for mayor and local authorities, like our own, is going to be to franchise the bus network, or there's the option to go down and enhance partnership of routes. Now, I fully understand and accept Arriva's positions that they don't like the franchising idea, so I'm not going to ask you that. But what sort of significant things would you come to the table with offering under an enhanced partnership? What kind of things would you suggest you'd be prepared to sort of put into that very deep, close working partnership?
Yeah, you've set me up here, haven't you? I think I'd like to think our relationship over the last 10 years, when we had the presentation for Passenger Foulkes, we were getting a lot of questions about what's the difference about your partnership. And I think the difference between our partnership is that we trust each other. I think that's very, very important going forward. I do think I've touched on one before that's close to somebody's heart that's sitting over there. I think enhanced partnerships are the best way to go, because I still believe that we can deliver what you want, and by also keeping it commercial as well. So I think there's a balance in that to be had. You're putting me on the spot, asking what else
I
can make
suggestions if you want.
You can find a way you're suggesting. I'd like to think that, given the history between us, what we said we'd do last time, I'd like to believe that people in the room think we can deliver. So you've asked us to look at things, and we've always delivered for you. I think that's important. I think and it goes back to that trust, and if need be, we're not frightened of franchising, I would say that. We've got a lot of experience in sort of how that works. But I do believe that we can offer a better deal, and I'm sure that, given our relationship as operators, I'm sure that your list will be ticked off, Lynn.
Yeah,
don't say that.
Prepare a lengthy one then. Yeah, obviously kind of looking forward to those very deep conversations, I'm sure. That's all the ones I was going to ask, but so just to sum up, thanks ever so much for the presentation. Thanks ever so much for asking all those, answering all those questions. The bits I've noted down that you kind of said that you're happy to work with us looking at the options on include things like short hop fare, the demand responsive transport, something for 19 to 23 year olds, and sort of